Good morning to one and all for the today's session in energy engineering. So today we'll be discussing about same thing, we'll be continuing with the tidal energy. Okay, in that tidal energy we'll be discussing first of all about the limitations of tidal power plant. So what are the limitations of tidal power plant? So the limitation, it can be harnessed only if natural sites are available. Okay, its suitable sites are mostly bays which are far away from the load centers. Therefore, the transmission cost of power is high. Its operation is uneven as turbines have to work with varying water heads. The power output is variable. Next one is the construction period of the dam for basin is long. The basin and the plant construction is very costly. Okay, sedimentation and slit deposition in the basin takes place in a regular manner, which is costly to be removed. Power output varies with lunar cycle. Okay, remember this, power output varies with lunar cycle. Next one, supply of water depends on the timing of tides and it is not continuous. Supply of water depends on the timing of the tides and it is not continuous. Sea water is corrosive. Life of the tidal power equipment is affected by the corrosive nature of sea water. Okay. Next one, efficiency of the plant is affected due to variable tidal range. Next one, that is last one, more turbines are to be used to obtain sufficient power as water head is small. Okay, next we'll be discussing about the classification of the tidal power plant. So under, first of all, how tidal plants are classified on the basis of basin used. How tidal plants are classified on the basis of basins used. Okay, the tidal power plants are classified on the basis of basins used as follows. First one is single basin system and second one is double basin system. So you all can see in the sketch, we have shown single base, single ebb cycle and single tide cycle. This figure A is single ebb cycle and single figure B is single tide cycle and third one is double cycle. Okay. So first of all, we'll discuss about single basin system. Okay. So what is single basin system? Single basin system is the simplest system to generate tidal power. The single basin tidal plant has only one basin to store water. Okay. Only one basin to store water. Remember this. The basin is separated from the ocean or sea by a dam. The turbines and generators are mounted within the ducts inside the dam. Okay, the single basin system can be further classified into single ebb cycle system. Single ebb cycle system, which is shown in a figure A. Okay, and single tide cycle the system, that is shown in figure B. This is a single tide. Okay, and the double cycle system is the figure C, which is known as double cycle system. In single ebb system, the sea water fills up. Okay, in this single ebb system, the sea water fills up the basin through the sluice walls when water level rises in high tides. When water level rises in high tides, the stored water in basin is made to run the turbines when the level of sea water decreases during low tides, as shown in figure A. This figure A. Okay. The turbines generate power using generators. The power output from this system is intermittent as power can be generated only during low tides. Okay. Next, coming to this figure B, that is single tide cycle system. Okay, in this the water is made to enter into the basin through turbines during the high tides. Remember one thing, the water is made to enter into the basin through the turbines during high tides. When high tides period is over, the sea level starts falling, which reduces the head on turbines. The power generation is stopped as the sea level reduces with the one set of low tides. The basin is drained of water through the sluice ways as sea level is lower during low tides. The power output is therefore intermittent. Okay, next coming to this double cycle system. Double cycle system. So, in double cycle system, reversible turbines are installed. Reversible turbines are installed. Okay. The power is generated during both filling and emptying the emptying of the basin. Filling of the basin is done during the high tides when water level in the basin. Filling of the basin is done during high tides when water level in the basin is low. Okay. Okay. This process is of filling and this is of emptying, you all can see. Okay. The water is made to flow through the turbine into basin to run the generators. Emptying of the basin is done during the low tides when sea level is low and the level in the basin is high. Once again, I'll repeat it. The water is made to flow out of the basin through the turbines into the sea to run the generators. Okay. And the water is made to flow through the turbines into the basin to run the generators after emptying of the basin is done during low tides when sea level is low and level in the basin is high. Level in the basin will be high at that time. Okay. The flow of water is therefore used in both directions to drive the reversible turbines. In both direction, you all can see that arrow mark shown in the direction at right side as well as left side and right side. In this, you all can see left side and right side, that is reverse direction. Okay. So, in this system, also continuous power generation is not possible. It takes some time to change from filling to empty the modes of the system. Filling and empty the modes of the system. We need some time. Okay. Next, we'll be discussing about double basin system. Double basin system, you all can see the sketch here. Okay. In double basin system, the double basin power plant has two basins at different levels. Two basins at, once again I'll repeat, two basins at different levels. The dam is provided between the basins. Dam is provided between the two basins. One is upper basin and another is lower basin. As shown in figure, you all can see. One is upper basin and another is low basin. In between that, dam is situated. Okay. So the dam is provided between the basins and sea as well as at between the basins. Sea as well as between the basins. One basin is called upper basin as the water level in this basin is always maintained higher than in the lower basin. Okay. One of them is known as upper basin. Okay. Since the water level in the basin is always maintained higher than in the lower basin. Okay. You all got this. The lower basin discharges water to the sea at low tides. The lower basin the lower basin discharges water to the sea at low tides. Okay, at low tides, while the upper basin is filled up with the sea water with high tides. The turbines are provided in the constructed dam. Turbines are provided in the constructed dam. Okay, in the constructed dam separating upper and lower basins. This is the turbine units are constructed in the dam, separating upper and lower basins. When the water is made to flow through the turbines from upper basin to lower basin, the turbines run and the generators coupled with the generate power with the help of this powerhouse. You all can see this is the powerhouse. You all got? Next we'll be discussing about site requirements. Okay, site requirements, in that first one comes high tidal range, second one comes short length of dam to create a basin of reasonable storage, and it is possible at narrow inlet to an estuary or bay. Okay, next one comes nearer to load location, and next one is should be protected from high waves. And next one comes should not hamper the shipping traffic. Next one we'll be discussing about tidal power plant in India. So you all can see, first one, the sites suitable for tidal power development in India are as follows. It is, first one is Gulf of Kutch, that is in Gujarat. Gulf of Kambat in Gujarat. Third one, Sundarbans Delta, West Bengal. Gulf of Cambay, Gujarat. And last one is Pitts Creek, that is in West Bengal. Okay. After this, we will be discussing about working principle of ocean thermal energy conversion. Okay. So, ocean thermal energy conversion is an indirect method of utilizing solar energy. Okay. Ocean thermal energy conversion is an indirect method of utilizing solar energy. A large amount of solar energy as thermal energy is collected and stored in a tropical oceans. What I am saying, you all are getting, no? The amount of solar energy as thermal energy is collected and stored in a tropical oceans. The surface of the water acts as the collector of the solar heat. The upper water layer in the ocean acts as a infinite heat storage reservoir or in a hot temperature source, while the deep water layer in oceans acts as a lower temperature sink. Solar heat absorption in the ocean water takes place according to the Lambert's law of absorption. Okay. Lambert's law of absorption. According to this law, each layer of equal water thickness in ocean absorbs the same fraction of solar heat when solar radiation passes through the ocean water. The radiation intensity in waterfalls with the depth, according to the following relation, dI by dy, that is equal to mu I dot I naught, where I naught is the solar radiation intensity at y is equal to 0 and mu is the absorption coefficient. On integrating, we get I is equal to I naught e raised to minus mu y. Okay, the above relation shows that the radiation intensity falls exponentially with the depth Why? Most of the solar radiation is absorbed very close to the upper surface compared to deep water. Therefore, the maximum temperature exists just below the upper surface due to solar heating, and lower temperature exists at deep water due to absence of the solar heating. The temperatures are maintained as high at surface and low at deep waters as no thermal convection currents between the warmer and the light water at the top and the colder and heavy water at the bottom of the ocean can take place. Okay. The warm water stays at the top and cold water stays at the bottom. The warm water stays at the top and cold water stays at the bottom, thereby forming two infinite heat reservoirs of constant temperature, that is a heat source at the top at about 27 degrees Celsius and a heat sink at about 4 degrees Celsius. Heat source at the top at about 27 degrees Celsius and heat sink at about 4 degrees Celsius at some depth from the top. These reservoirs are maintained by the absorption of solar radiation on a regular basis. A heat engine can work between this heat source and heat sink to convert heat into mechanical work. The efficiency of the heat engine is limited to Carnot engine efficiency, which is given by efficiency is equal to T1 minus T2 divided by T1, where T1 is the source temperature in Kelvin and T2 is the sink temperature in Kelvin. In case we take T1 is equal to 27 degrees Celsius and T2 is equal to 7 degrees Celsius, we have efficiency is equal to 27 plus 273 minus of 7 plus 273 divided by 27 plus 273. That you will be getting the efficiency as 6.67%. The ocean thermal energy can be converted into mechanical or electrical energy when the temperature difference between the warm water at surface and cold water at the depth is about 20 to 25 degrees Celsius. This temperature difference generally exists in tropical oceans. The utilization of this ocean thermal energy, where suitable temperature difference exists between the warm surface water and the cold water at the depth in tropical oceans, by its conversion into mechanical work, forms the basis of a tank system. The warm surface water can also be used to heat some low boiling point refrigerant to obtain high pressure vapors which can run as a gas turbine to obtain the mechanical work. Okay. Next we'll be discussing about ocean thermal energy conversion system. So OTEC, OTEC, that is short form of ocean thermal energy conversion system. OTEC plants can operate using open cycle, closed cycle. The open cycle is also known as a cloud cycle, while the closed cycle is known as a Anderson cycle. So next we will be discussing about open cycle and closed cycle. While viewing the figure, you all can see that the difference between the open cycle and the closed cycle. First of all, we'll be discussing about open cycle. Okay. Warm water from the top surface is evaporated. Warm water from the surface is evaporated. Okay. Warm water. You all can see this portion which is carrying a warm water. Which is warm water from the top surface is evaporated to obtain low pressure steam by using the flash evaporator. maintained at partial vacuum, as water can evaporate at low temperature when pressure is lower than the atmospheric pressure. The low pressure steam obtained from the flash evaporator is expanded in the in this turbine. Expanded in this turbine. Okay. Expanded in the turbine to extract mechanical energy. Okay. The steam after energy removal in turbine is condensed into water. Is condensed into water. You can see the condenser in which we are going to condense the steam over here. Okay. Condensed, which is cooled by a cold water drawn from the depths in the ocean. The working of an open cycle plant is shown in figure. That is the figure. Okay. Next one, we'll be discussing about closed cycle. Closed cycle. In a closed cycle, warm surface water is used to evaporate. Warm surface water. This is a warm surface water, which we are going to use to evaporate a low boiling point refrigerant. Low boiling point refrigerant. And a refrigerant vapor is made to flow through the turbine to extract energy. To extract energy. Okay. The vapor coming out from the turbine after performing work is cooled and condensed in a condenser. Condensed in the condenser. This condenser cooled by the cold water pumped from the ocean depths. Water pumped from the ocean depths. The closed cycle. Such plant is much compact in size and less costly compared to open cycle. We prefer closed cycle because it is a much compact in size and less costly compared to this open cycle. Okay. Next, we'll be discussing few important OTEC plants installed all over the world. Okay. Many countries are actively involved in research and development of OTEC plants. The plants that have been planned and launched are launched. Okay. First one, that is France has built a 5 megawatt OTEC shore plant in Tahiti. Second one, a 50 kilowatt floating plant has been built at island of Nauru in Japan. Another 20 megawatts power plant is to be built by Tokyo Electric Company. Okay. Third one is a 10 megawatts closed cycle plant in Caribbean or Pacific Ocean and a 500 kilowatt closed cycle onshore plant in Hawaii have been planned by the United Kingdom. Okay. Next one, a 100 kilowatt onshore plant has been completed at Bali. Another 10 megawatts floating plant is under planning by the Dutch. Okay. Next one, a 22 kilowatts OTEC plant at Cuba was built in 1930. A 10 megawatts OTEC plant at Guam has been planned. And the last one, a 1 megawatt OTEC plant at the coast of Lakshadweep Island has been planned. Okay, next we'll be discussing about the merits and demerits of the OTEC plants. So, what are the merits and demerits of the OTEC plants? The advantages are as follows. So, the plant can supply power without any fluctuation in all vagaries of weather. The power output does not vary from the season to season here. Okay, the power output does not vary from season to season. प्लांट नीड्स यूजुअल थर्मोडायनेमिक डिवाइसेस एंड इक्विपमेंट सच एज टर्बाइन, हीट एक्सचेंजर एंड कंडेंसर. द प्लांट नीड्स यूजुअल थर्मोडायनेमिक डिवाइसेस एंड इक्विपमेंट सच एज टर्बाइन, हीट एक्सचेंजर एंड कंडेंसर. ओके, द यूजफुल बाय प्रोडक्ट्स फ्रॉम द ओटीईसी प्लांट आर डिसेलिनेटेड वाटर न्यूट्रिएंट्स फ्रॉम मराइन कल्चर. द प्लांट कैन बी कंस्ट्रक्टेड ऑन शोर लाइन और अ फ्लोटिंग प्लांट प्लेटफॉर्म. द प्लांट ऑफ एनी साइज और कैपेसिटी कैन बी कंस्ट्रक्टेड एट अ सुटेबल साइट. ओके, द डीमेरिट्स एज लो टेम्परेचर डिफरेंस एग्जिस्ट इन अपर सरफेस एंड डीप वाटर thereby plants has very low efficiency in converting ocean thermal energy. Hence, a large plant size at huge cost has to be constructed to meet the power requirement. Second one, the design, operation and maintenance of flash evaporator in the open system are problematic. Third one, the design of the steam turbine to operate at low pressure is problematic. Okay, the large size of heat exchanger to work as a boiler is problematic while designing the closed system. The development of pumps suitable for handling large amounts of water is problematic. Long distance cable to transmit power to shore is required. The plant has to withstand severe ocean conditions and storms. The plant equipment has to resist the corrosive effects of ocean water. The plant has to remove algae growth on a regular basis. Okay. The whole plant has to be constructed on floats. Equipment has to be installed at a greater depth to reach the cold water level. The plant at shoreline may require pipes of large diameter and length for handling water. Okay. Next one will be the environmental impacts due to OTEC plants. The marine life can be destroyed due to water circulation. The plant may affect ecosystem and impact coral. It can also influences ocean currents and climate. The plant releases a large quantity of cold water into warmer surface environment, which may adversely affect the marine life. The carbon dioxide dissolved in warm water is released to the atmosphere in an open cycle, which has greenhouse effect on environment. Next, we'll be discussing about resource of geothermal energy. Okay, resource of geothermal energy. You all can see the figure here. We have shown here magma, hydrothermal reservoir. It constructs well bored, fissure, geyser, pond, and the water passing from the pond to the hydrothermal reservoir. Okay. The molten mass of earth is called magma. What is magma? The molten mass of earth is called magma. This is the magma we have shown in the figure. Okay. The earth's crust over the magma is about, just a minute, the earth's crust over the magma is about 32 kilometer of on an average. However, at certain places owing the earth tremors, the magma happens to come closer to the earth's surface. This pressure of hot magma near to the earth's surface creates active volcanoes, hot springs, and geysers. Geysers we have shown here in the figure, geysers. Okay. It also causes steam to vent through the fissures when underground. We have shown fissures in the figure here, okay? When underground water comes into contact with the magma. When underground water comes in contact with this magma, fissures are formed, okay? There are five types of geothermal resources, which include hydrothermal geopressures, hot dry rock, active volcanic vents, and magma. Hydrothermal resources contain superheated water. Okay. Hydrothermal resources contain superheated water, steam, or both in fractured or porous rock, but further trapped by a layer of impermeable rock. Hydrothermal resource may give dry and pure steam with temperatures above 240 degrees Celsius. However, majority of these resources have moderate temperatures ranging from 100 to 180 degrees Celsius, while few resources have high temperatures ranging from 150 to 200 degrees Celsius. To use hydrothermal energy, wells have to be drilled to reach a fissure or hydrothermal reservoir. To reach the fissure or the hydrothermal reservoir. Okay. Geopressurized resource is hot water or brine trapped underground at the depth about 2400 to 9100 meter with temperature of about 160 degrees Celsius. The pressure of water is about 1000 bars, although it has a great heat potential for power generation, but it is uneconomical due to low temperature and high cost of drilling into Earth's surface to such a great depth. In case brine has recoverable methane, brine water can be used with combustion methane to generate electricity. Hot dry rocks or petrothermal resources consist of high temperature rocks ranging from 90 to 650 degrees Celsius. The rocks can be fractured and water may be circulated through the rocks to extract the thermal energy. Okay. Next, we'll be discussing about structures of Earth's interior. In that, first one is crust, second one is mantle, and the third one is core. So first of all, we'll discuss about this crust. It is the uppermost shell of the earth that extends to variable depths below mountains, okay, continents and oceans. The thickness of the crust is believed to be 0.90 kilometer, and several substances like limestone, coal, gold, petroleum, etc. are found in the crust. Next one, we'll be discussing about mantle. It is the second concentric shell of earth that lies below the crust. The upper rigid part of the mantle extends up to 100 kilometer below the separating crust and contains mainly iron and magnesium. The crust and upper mantle from the lithosphere, the lower mantle extending up to 2900 kilometer below the earth's surface, is less rigid and is hotter. This is known as isohenosphere and is capable of being deformed. The movement of the lithosphere over the asthenosphere results in the phenomena of plate tectonics, like movement of earth's crust. Okay. Next one, we'll be discussing about the core. It is the innermost concentric shell of the earth. The core boundary begins at a depth of 2900 kilometer from the surface and extends टू द सेंटर ऑफ द अर्थ एट 6,370 किलोमीटर, दिस लेयर इज फर्दर सब डिवाइडेड इन टू आउटर कोर एंड द इनर कोर, आउटर कोर एंड द इनर कोर. ओके, the outer core comprises the region from the depth of 2900 km to 5200 km below the earth's surface and behaves mere like a liquid. The inner core with a thickness of around 1170 km is believed to be solid metallic body containing nickel iron alloy. Okay, the hot molten rock of the mantle is called magma. Next we'll be discussing about the diagram shown of depicting how springs are produced through the hot magma, the fractured crystalline rocks, the permeable rocks and ferrocolloidal groundwater. Ferrocolloidal, permeable rock, crystallizing rock. These are shown in this figure. You all can see hot spring, how hot springs are produced. Okay. At the depth of 5,000 meter or so lies an impermeable magma. Above the magma are the impermeable rocks. Above the magma are the impermeable rocks shown. Okay. Above the magma are the impermeable rocks which are overlain by the localized pockets. Overlain by the localized pockets. Okay. Of permeable rocks. One such localized pocket is shown in this figure. The localized pocket are bounded by fracture zones of faults along which some relative motion of rocks has occurred, water circulating along the fault lines as it goes down and moves in Earth's interior is heated by the permeable layer, which is in turn heated by conduction of heat from the magma. The hot water comes out through another fault and forms a hot spring. Over here, hot spring we have shown here, pure water from this, and hot springs are shown here with a dotted. You all can see this. Okay, thank you for today's. We'll stop here for the today's session. Thank you for the today's session. If you have any doubts, you can discuss with me. Thank you.